So what are we going to cover? What am I going to cover today? I want to give you an introduction to who we are, who Nutrition Services is at Dana-Farber. What is integrative nutrition? We're going to talk about some common side effects and treatment of side effects with brain tumors and their treatment. Certain diet and diet modifications that are frequently asked questions that I get. And then in general, what are our recommendations? Okay, so our team at Dana-Farber, we have six senior clinical dietitians here. We have very full schedules, which is just a great nod to the fact that the care teams notice how important nutrition is, and they refer their patients to us on a regular basis. If you're not referred and you do have some issues or questions or concerns, you can reach out and you can schedule an appointment. We come to you usually, or we'll have a consult in a consult room, but oftentimes we'll come when people are getting infusion in chemotherapy. We can come so we can kind of multitask while you're getting your chemo. We can do a nutrition consult, or I might see you right before or right after radiation, down on the lower level. So, we come to you, we kind of try to be as efficient as possible while you're here. And then we have some interns and volunteers that work with us. And to stay up in terms of technology, we now have an app. We've had the app for a little while. But for those of you that like to kind of use your gadgets and use your smartphones, we do have an app which has a ton of recipes. It also talks about ways to troubleshoot some common side effects of treatment. So that's nice and handy to have too, as like a quick resource. Okay, in terms of integrative approach to nutrition, it's really easy. The first thing, obviously, that comes to mind for us is food. However, if we only address the food and kind of the macronutrients and the supplements, we're missing so much richness that is involved in our patients' nutrition. For example, a lot of us have very interesting relationships with food. Some of my patients say, just tell me what to eat. Just tell me what I should be eating. And they want to know in terms of protein or carbohydrate or fat or what should I avoid, what should I eat. And for a lot of people, you don't have to raise your hand, but maybe just like take note, food is comfort. Food is how we express our love to one another. It's how we take care of boredom. It's how we take care of stress. So for some of us, it is more along the lines of nourishment. We think of it as fuel. And for other people, it's what we do at the end of the day to unwind and de-stress. And for some people, it's both. And we can hold both of those experiences. So when I go into a consult with somebody, I'm curious what their relationship with food is. Where is it? Has it changed as they've gone into treatment? And then kind of along with that, to look at the relationships that they have with other people, family and friends. And I notice, and I try to be really savvy and pick up on how nutrition and how eating and the side effects related to food are affecting relationships between patients and family members and friends. So again, just going back to that, what I just spoke of with that relationship with food and food as comfort or food as, you know, de-stressing. That's also how we show people we love them. Well, in certain cultures, particularly maybe more than others. But, you know, chicken soup, right? Somebody's sick or church members will bring over homemade foods. It's how we say we love you and we're thinking of you and we want to take care of you. And then when you go and you present that to somebody that's nauseous or has loss of appetite and they can't eat it, it can create tension. Really great intentions of people to feed and take care of one another through food. But when it's not received or somebody's not feeling well or they can't eat it, it's just really interesting. And it's important for us to take note of what that does to relationships. It can be incredibly stressful. And so sometimes my role is to help navigate the eating relationship and the feeding relationship with patients and their families. Okay, and then of note on the bottom right side of the screen, media, the World Wide Web, and Dr. Rosenthal spoke a little bit about this in terms of the internet. A lot of the questions that I get are from people that see a study that has come up And maybe it was on the news, it was on the internet, it was somewhere that looks super legitimate, right? Like Fox, it was on Fox News, so it's got to be something, right? The problem is that Fox News doesn't screen their material to see how good of a clinical trial or study it was. How many people were in the study? Were there six? Should we consider that a well-done trial, a well-done experiment, or look at a certain supplement or diet? They don't screen for that, and that's actually one of the benefits of coming and getting a nutrition consult here is that we take that stuff very seriously, and we make sure before we give out recommendations in terms of including a supplement or trying a diet or something like that, that it goes through rigorous amounts of trials or we have enough research to really feel comfortable supporting it. And unless it does, you're not going to hear us recommending those types of diets or supplements. Okay, so some of this is a little bit of a review from earlier today. We know that with the brain tumors themselves, there are neurological symptoms that can affect your nourishment, your nutrition, and how you eat. Things like changes in cognition, movement, and vision. So in terms of preparing for people that maybe were the primary food procurers and food makers in the home and meal makers in the home, in terms of preparing and eating these foods, things might significantly change. And so the shift of responsibility for meal making might now go on to somebody else. And so that's important to consider. Also, dysphagia can be common in terms of having difficulty swallowing foods, and the muscular movement sometimes can be affected with brain tumors as well. So usually that's a reason to do a referral to our speech and language pathology team here at the hospital, which is excellent. And they can help in terms of giving tips and recommendations, chin tucks or other ways to make sure that food is going down safely. Nausea, vomiting, fatigue, again, very common. And we're not even talking about the side effects of treatment yet. This is just of the tumor burden on its own, creating these effects, side effects that might impact nutrition. And then we have syndrome of inappropriate antidiuretic hormone secretion, which sometimes this can create extra fluid retention in people and low sodium levels. So in terms of nutrition, we might do things like a fluid restriction, adjusting sodium intake, things like that. Okay, so now on top of it, and you'll notice some significant overlap here with side effects of the tumor itself and then side effects of the treatment to treat the tumor. Nausea, vomiting, and fatigue, again, we're seeing that. So this can kind of be a double whammy for people. Now they're also getting it from their treatment. Inflammation, and then the resulting steroid use. Steroid use tends to increase individuals' protein needs, so we need to keep in mind, and also their blood sugars can be elevated with steroid use, so we take it into consideration what kind of medications they're on if there is inflammation present. And then diarrhea and constipation are really common in terms of a lot of different chemotherapy treatments. So how do we manage this through nutrition? Fatigue, nausea, and a lot of the other symptom management in terms of nutrition, you're going to see and you're going to hear people talk about doing smaller, more frequent meals. So if you think about it, the last time you had nausea, whether you're a patient or your caregiver, just experiencing or remembering what the experience of nausea is like, the last thing you want to do is sit down with this huge plate of food in front of you. It's overwhelming. It's too much. If you're tired, you're not going to be able to make it through that meal without being exhausted and overwhelmed. So on many different levels, the idea of doing smaller, more frequent meals is more manageable. And then whether you're a patient that's doing food preparation or you're a caregiver, thinking about making things more simple. So creating a couple meals, a baked oatmeal or a chili or a soup, and freezing it in individual portion sizes and then just pulling it out throughout the week and heating up is much more easy, takes the burden of food prep off of the table, no pun intended. And then easy to eat and easy to prepare foods if you're tired or if you have loss of appetite. So you don't maybe want to put together a fancy ornate like sushi meal where you have to be manipulating sushi rolls and dipping and all of this kind of stuff. You might want to do like peanut butter crackers. Something that's easy to pick up, is nutrient dense, but there isn't a lot of difficulty in terms of getting it into the mouth, but it's still nutrient dense. Again, dysphagia, we work very closely alongside of our speech and language pathologists, but in terms of giving out specific recommendations for safe swallowing or food consistencies, that's in their wheelhouse. But then we help come up with ideas if they say you should have some thickened liquids or you should be doing pureed foods or something like that to prevent aspiration. We work very closely with them to come up with really specific food recommendations. Nausea. Interestingly, you'll see on there foods that are rich in sodium and potassium. Sometimes, interestingly, people are craving potato chips. So like, what's the deal with potato chips? So potato chips can be really helpful because they have that sodium, they're light, and they can kind of calm the stomach before a trial of eating. So sometimes we'll just have people munch on a few potato chips before they do one of their mini meals, and that's enough to kind of calm the stomach and get them ready to get a little bit more nutrition in them. So chips, potato chips, ginger, there's, again, Dr. Rosenthal was talking about a lot of this stuff. We like to encourage, if we have some like trial research behind it or a lot of experiential, you know, reports of this kind of stuff working. But ginger also, in addition to our patients saying that it's really helpful, there is some research done to show the effects, the beneficial of, effects of ginger in terms of nausea. So that might just mean cutting fresh root, steeping it in some hot water. It might mean ginger chews or crystallized ginger that's pretty readily available at supermarkets now. Diarrhea and constipation, so again, changes in bowel movements and adjusting fiber in one direction or the other is kind of one of the easiest ways to kind of manipulate diarrhea, constipation. Sometimes these are really hard and people will say, I kind of swing from one to the other. I experience both from one day to the next, and it can be kind of difficult to manage. So like a lot of the other side effects, that's why it's beneficial to get a nutrition consult, because your experience through treatment is very unique to you. And so we need to meet you where you are. And, you know, if you're having a couple days of constipation or diarrhea, maybe we do oatmeal if you swing really quickly from one way to the other, because that has two types of fiber and it can be helpful if you have diarrhea and it can be helpful if you're constipated. So, you know, kind of meeting with a dietitian to figure out where you are and what might be helpful. Smooth Move contains an herb, senna, which is a bowel stimulant, which helps contract the bowel and create a bowel movement. So that's a little bit more of like a natural herbal remedy for people that have constipation. Prune juice for constipation. So again, and you'll hear this no matter which dietitian you talk to, we go whole food or, you know, as natural, you know, in terms of remedies or addressing side effects as possible. So if we can have you do prune juice or prunes, which honestly tends to really help for a lot of people, we go there first before we do some of the other more medicinal approaches. Decreased appetite, I tend to treat this a lot like nausea. So just smaller, more frequent meals is easier than just putting a huge plate of food usually turns somebody off. If you're a loved one and you're like, I just really want them to eat, I'll make anything, and if they're not eating a lot, the thinking is if I put a lot of food in them, they're in front of them, they're more likely to eat more. But it usually has the exact opposite effect. So it's better to put in front of somebody a small portion size, and then you can just always refill or reload. But to put a huge plate of food usually just stops the eating before it even starts. And then I put down here calm eating environment. I just recently had a patient that it had never come up before in any of our consults, and she just mentioned that her home life is, there's like a lot of arguing and there's a lot of issues and there's a lot of tension, not even really involving her, but there's some really tricky relationships in the home and it's stressing her out and she doesn't want to eat. And I thought, oh man, I can't believe we didn't talk about this before. So I said, is there any opportunity for you to kind of get away, or is there a place you could go? And she said, well, when I go to my daughter's house, I mean, like, I'm picking in her garden, I'm like eating, I'm popping tomatoes in my mouth, I'm like, you know, we chat and we eat. I'm going to my friend's house. When I go to her house, she's going there for a week, she's gonna like be able to eat all this food. I'm like, yes. So don't underestimate the importance of your eating environment. It needs to be calm. Like, if you typically associate your bedroom with like sleeping, and you might not want to eat in there. You might want to go out into the patio or the kitchen or somewhere else where it feels good and it feels comfortable and the temperature is right and the lighting is right to support eating and to support nutrition. So thinking about having a calm, stress-free, so like, make sure your partner's not sitting across from you, like eyeballing your plate and giving you like laser beams to finish all the food on your plate. That's really common as well. So calm environment. Taste changes. This can be a side effect of some chemotherapies as well. People don't think about rinsing out their mouth before they eat. They think about like good oral hygiene and rinsing out, cleaning out their mouth afterwards. But actually rinsing out your mouth before you eat, because chemo can be systemic, it's in your saliva too. So rinsing out your mouth before you eat might kind of cleanse your palate and make foods, either if they're usually bland, you might be able to taste a little bit more, or if foods taste a little bit off, you might actually be able to get the actual true taste of the food. Okay. Diets, diet modifications. These are a few that I get asked, particularly more frequently. The last two have been coming up more in terms of the media, and there are some really small kind of preliminary trials with some of these going on. And then organic is one I just get on a regular basis, so I thought I'd throw that in there. Currently, in terms of organic, there isn't any evidence that suggests eating organic has an effect in terms of cancer incidence or outcome. However, we do know that there is higher pesticide residue in conventionally grown produce. So people say, okay, so what do I do with that? And my answer is that it's kind of a personal choice. And with that said, if you want to make some kind of informed decisions in terms of what foods you do organically versus conventionally, you can use the environmental working groups, that's the EWG, that's what that stands for. They're online, and I think it's biannually or maybe annually, they come up with something called the Dirty Dozen, and they just recently started coming up with the Clean 15 to let people know which produce tends to be more heavily pesticized and which tend to be very minimally pesticized, so that if you decide you want to spend the money on organic, which ones do you want to spend the money on, which would maybe be more beneficial in terms of reducing your residue exposure. So this can be, again, a tool that if you are not sure which direction to go in terms of purchasing produce, this, you can just keep this in your back pocket. That said, what we do know is consuming a high plant-based diet, consuming foods that are colorful and rich in antioxidants and phytonutrients, is beneficial at baseline in terms of preventing, in terms of going through treatment, and in terms of preventing recurrence. So if it's a choice between I'm not going to eat any of these because I'm afraid of pesticide residue, or you know, we want you to be getting your color in. We want you to get your phytonutrients in. So, you know, if it's conventional or nothing, go conventional, is my personal opinion. Okay, the ketogenic diet. So this is the next two, the ketogenic and fasting, are kind of new on the scene. Again, meaning that there are some really small trials that have been going on, but they're new, and in terms of recommending to do it or not do it, we're holding off, and we don't recommend actually doing this diet until there's more evidence to say one way or another. What exactly is the ketogenic diet? Ketogenic diet is a very, very low carbohydrate diet, high fat diet, moderate protein diet. When the body doesn't consume, when we don't consume a lot of carbohydrate, we actually start producing something called ketones, or we turn fat into ketones in our body. And the brain prefers glucose, it prefers carbohydrate, so if we're not getting it, the brain can actually use these ketones for fuel. Healthy brain cells can use ketones for fuel, but what they're finding is that cancerous brain cells aren't able to adapt and use that fuel. And so the thinking, the theory behind it is then that they aren't able to grow, and potentially we slow down the growth of cancer, brain cancer cells. So that's the theory. Again, the data and the research isn't consistent enough for us in terms of nutrition to advocate this, so we're not at this point. We're keeping a pulse on it, and we're waiting for a little bit more research to surface for us to say kind of one direction or another. Fasting. So fasting also kind of new on the scene. What is it? Just what it sounds like. So this is just consuming water for anywhere between 40 hours before to 5 to 50 hours after. Again, you can see how like up in the air this is at this point. The thinking behind this is fasting is a very stressful state for the body, and normal cells will kind of go into this maintenance mode. They don't continue to proliferate, whereas cancer cells aren't able to slow down and maintain. They continue to proliferate. So if they continue to proliferate while you're getting chemotherapy, the chemotherapy can essentially attack those, but your other cells, the theory again, is remain relatively safe throughout the chemotherapy treatment. So with fasting, so far, very small groups of people that have tried this find that they have less side effects in terms of nausea, vomiting, fatigue, again, because less healthy cells, the idea is, are affected because of the fasting state. So again, we're keeping a pulse on this, and there are some ongoing phase one trials that are underway right now. So we'll keep you updated in terms of what we think about these diets as more information becomes available. Nutrition, again, if we just talk about what's available through the media, the World Wide Web, it's so confusing. It's very dynamic. And it keeps me in business because I'm constantly having to, you know, help people flesh through a lot of this information because it can be just really overwhelming and confusing. So it's a very dynamic field. And again, just to reiterate that we really wait until there's studies that are repeated and tested and repeated. We have good double-blind placebo-controlled studies before we advocate a lot of this. So what do we recommend? I just said some things that are like up in the air, and we'll wait and hang on, we'll let you know. So when I go in and meet with somebody, what do we talk about? So the first thing that I'm actually talking about, healthful fats and lean proteins, this essentially is going in line with a lot of the common side effects with this particular type of cancer, which is, again, kind of loss of appetite, nausea, fatigue. So if people aren't able to sit down and have regular meals, and regular portions of food like they used to, I want to make sure that when you're sitting down, you're getting as much nutrient-dense foods in if you're doing really small portion sizes. So healthful fats and lean proteins tend to be where those how we get that kind of nutrition in. If you think about healthy fats, right, a tablespoon of olive oil added to soup adds another 120 calories of monounsaturated healthy fats. So if somebody's having difficulty or losing weight through treatment, that's an easy way. We didn't just make that bowl of soup three times bigger. It's the same size, but we added 120 calories. So healthful fats, thinking about avocados, nuts, nut butters, peanut butter is one of our favorites. And then lean proteins. Again, this whole process of radiation, chemotherapy, depending on some of your medications that you're on, it's very inflammatory, and we need to be able to repair and heal tissue, and protein is one of the main sources to be able to repair and heal from your treatment, during treatment and after. So thinking about your lean protein sources, beans, legumes, edamame, soy, fish, fatty fish, like Dr. Rosenthal was talking about, your wild your wild-caught fish, and lean meats, turkey, chicken, things like that. And then color. The more color in your diet, the better. Again, do we avoid conventional because we're worried about residue? If it's that or nothing, please have your fruits and vegetables. Fresh or frozen are just as good as fresh. So if you're worried about convenience or you're worried about cost, frozen, A-OK. And that's easy in terms of food prep for people as well if fatigue is an issue. So just to give you a visual, like we have basic oatmeal. It has decent nutrition, right? But doesn't have a lot of calories maybe if we're worried about somebody getting in enough nutrition. So here's just a few, and I have to wrap up. I have like 30 seconds left, so I'm going to kind of go through this quickly. But thinking about, this is my favorite one, and you can totally steal this, but I did come up with this, so trademark it if you use it anywhere. So making oatmeal, hot oatmeal, and actually while you're cooking on the stove, whisking in eggs. So good. Now, it might sound weird, but you're adding protein, you're adding some healthy fat in the yolk, and it creates this like kind of like rice porridge type consistency. And you're getting, again, it's not just carb now, now we have protein. Adding nuts, there's some chia seed, coconut oil. Again, that bowl hasn't now gotten like this big. It's still kind of the same size, but there's a lot more nutrition in there. Drinking can often be easier than eating food. So thinking about making smoothies, maybe with some egg white or whey protein powder. Again, peanut butter, avocado make smoothies nice and rich, more monounsaturated fats. Ground flaxseed, okay? And I have some resources as well where you can get some more recipes and to continue kind of fleshing out some of the confusing nutrition information. But again, the best strategy is to book a consult because all of your nutrition needs are unique to you. So thank you. Thanks for your time.